Good evening. Most of you know who I am. I'm Pastor David Karlovsky. I serve at Lord and Savior in Crystal Lake. Pastor Bauer's written a beautiful service in our folder. Let's worship our God.
Almighty, grant us a quiet night and peace at the last. It is good to give thanks to the Lord. Your love in the morning, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
Let's sing our opening hymn, Rise My Soul to Watch and Pray. Arise for worship. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you in our thoughts, in our words, in our deeds, and in all that we have not done. Forgive us in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Deliver and restore us, that we may rest in peace. By the mercy of God, we are redeemed by Jesus Christ, and in him we are forgiven. Let us rest in his peace until the rising of the sun, when we shall serve him in newness of life.
Amen.
Seated. We hear now the sixth portion of the Passion history. This evening's entitled Jesus Suffering Before the Secular Authorities. And Pilate, when he had called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, said to them, "You have brought this man to me as one who misleads the people. And indeed, having examined him in your presence, I find no fault in this man concerning those things of which you accuse him. No, nor did Herod, for I sent you back to him, and indeed nothing worthy of death has been done by him. I will therefore chastise him and release him." Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release into the multitude one prisoner whom they wished. And there was at that time a notorious prisoner named Barabbas, who had been thrown into prison with his fellow insurrectionists, who had committed murder in the insurrection made in the city. And the multitude, crying aloud, began to ask him to do just as he had always done for them. And when they gathered together, Pilate answered, "You have a custom that I should release someone to you at the Passover. Whom do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, the King of the Jews, who is called Christ?" For he knew that the chief priests had delivered him because of envy. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent to him, saying, "Have nothing to do with that just man, for I have suffered many things today in a dream because of him." And the chief priests and the elders stirred up the people and persuaded them that they should ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" The whole crowd cried out, saying, "Away with this man, and release to us Barabbas." Pilate, therefore, wishing to release Jesus, spoke again to them, "What then shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ?" They all said to him, "Crucify him, crucify him." And he said to them the third time, "Why? What evil has he done? I find no reason for death in him. I will therefore chastise him and let him go." And they cried out more exceedingly, "Crucify him." And they were insistent, demanding with loud voices that he be crucified. And the voices of these men and of the chief priests prevailed. And Pilate took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole band of soldiers around him. And they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And when they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him and began to salute him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they struck him in the face and spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And bowing the knee, they worshiped him. Pilate then went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no fault in him." Then Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. And Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." Therefore, when the chief priests and officers saw him, they cried out, saying, "Crucify him, crucify him." Pilate said to them, "You take him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and by our law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God." Therefore, when Pilate heard that saying, he was the more afraid, and went again into the praetorium, and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Are you not speaking to me? Do you not know that I have the power to crucify you and power to release you?" Jesus answered, "You could have no power at all against me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who delivered me to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, saying, "If you let this man go, you are not Caesar's friend. Whoever makes himself a king speaks against Caesar." When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus out and sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the pavement, but in Hebrew, Gabbatha. And it was the preparation day of the Passover, and about the sixth hour. And he said to the Jews, "Behold your king." But they cried out, "Away with him, away with him, crucify him." Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." When Pilate saw that he could not prevail at all, but rather that a tumult was rising, he gave sentence that it should be as they requested. And he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, "I am innocent of the blood of this just person. You see to it." And all the people answered and said, "His blood be on us and on our children." Then he released to them Barabbas, whom they requested, who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder. But he delivered Jesus after he had scourged him to their will to be crucified. So far, this evening's portion of the Passion history.
I commend my spirit. Have redeemed me, O Lord, God of truth. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Let's continue our worship with hymn 104, Go to Dark Gethsemane.
Gethsemane, all who feel the tempter's power, your Redeemer's conflict see, watch with him one bitter hour, turn not from his griefs away, learn of Jesus Christ to pray. Follow to the judgment hall, you the worm, oh, the wormwood and the gall, oh, the pangs his soul sustained, shun not suffering, shame, or loss, learn of him to bear the miracle of time, God's own sacrifice complete. 'Tis finished, hear him cry, learn of Jesus Christ to die. He hastened to the tomb, they lay his breathless clay. Solitude and gloom,
grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father, and from our Lord, our Savior, the Lamb, Jesus Christ. Amen. All these Wednesdays of Lent, we've been considering a theme that highlights three words of truth. Tonight's three words are the words watch and pray. And as we watch and pray, it takes us to that place we just sang of, Gethsemane. We hear from God's Word this evening from St. Matthew's Gospel, the 26th chapter. But Peter declared, "Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you." And all the other disciples said the same. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Could you men not keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray, so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak." The word of the Lord. Before I begin, a brief prayer. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. You are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. People of God, paid for by the innocent blood of the Lamb. Do you have a fireplace? You know, a real wood-burning fireplace? When I was growing up, we did. And I have to tell you, my father loved it. My mother, not so much. Oh, we loved it as a family. It's a good family thing. We'd take newspapers and make these things called Nantucket knots, and we'd light the logs. We'd watch the flames dance, hear the logs crackle, the warmth, the glow. My father loved it, my mother not so much. You know why? It was when that fire was done. It left that dirty, filthy, sooty stuff called ash. My mother was the designated fireplace cleaner, and I was the designated fireplace cleaner's helper. Got that little shovel, got that ash. Dirty, filthy, sooty. Now, why do I mention that? Well, 6 weeks ago, our Lenten pilgrimage, our annual trek and journey to Calvary's Hill, started with that Wednesday called ash. And that black, dirty, sooty, filthy ash stuff reminds us of something, doesn't it? Our sin. We're here on this Lenten journey every year because of our sin. Sin that needed paying for. You heard me tell you that we were going to a garden this evening, Gethsemane. But before we get to Gethsemane, we have to go to another garden. And we have to go back a lot more centuries than just to Gethsemane's garden. We've got to go back to that garden called Eden. Where in that garden called Eden, that fork-tongued serpent teased and taunted and tempted and enticed and lured Eve and Adam to fall into that black, ugly, sooty stuff called sin. The whole world plummeted into destruction, but our God made a great promise. I'm going to send a Savior. I will put enmity between you and the woman, that great Genesis 3:15 promise. It took centuries and centuries and centuries until our God, whose timing is always right, sent his Son. And finally, the day had come when he would be arrested, tried and wrongly convicted, and crucified. But tonight, God's word takes us to that garden called Gethsemane, where with Peter, James, and John, we are encouraged in our three words to watch and pray. And it's interesting as we have this message, as we think about what kind of structure is this sermon going to have, it has two halves. Watch and pray. Let's consider the watch part, huh? You know, when we and I hear that term watch, what does it remind us? It reminds us to be alert, to be attentive, to be on guard. We hear that idea of watching, especially in those end time Sundays every year, don't we? Those ones at the end of November and beginning of December, when we're supposed to be watching, praying for our Savior's return. Same truth is applied here in that garden, to watch and pray, to stay alert. To stay alert, to stay ready, to watch and pray, because we know one that we're watching out for. It's that same one that was in the garden, that fork-tongued serpent, the devil, Satan. He never rests. One of my elderly members says about Satan, he ain't no gentleman. He's out to tease and entice and taunt. We know that he tempted even Jesus himself for those 40 days in the wilderness when Jesus fasted. And here Jesus is with those disciples, encouraged to watch. You know, that word watch reminds us to use our eyes. And as Jesus told those disciples to watch, it wasn't so much to watch for Judas or to watch for the soldiers, but to watch him. Peter, James, and John had some lessons to continue to learn from Jesus. And it's a good lesson, isn't it? It's good for us to go back to Gethsemane's garden regularly, and we see our Savior on his face. We see our Savior on the ground, and further accounts of this story in Gethsemane know that our Savior perspired, as it were, great drops of blood. Why? The disciples saw that. They were watching, they were observing. They were hearing, they were listening. You and I have come to know why. Jesus was carrying a heavy, heavy, beyond heavy burden. A heavy, 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 beyond heavy weight. The weight of your sins, mine too. The weight of the world's sins, the weight of the sins of all people of all time were on his shoulders. And we've come to know well that Jesus is true God and true man, and as true God, he knew what was coming that night and certainly the next day with the crown, with the nails, with the stripes, the scourging, the whipping, the battering, the bloodying, the spitting, the ridiculing, and all that was coming. A lot of times we dwell on the horror and the hideousness of crucifixion. As true God, he knew what was about to take place. And as true man, his human flesh reeled at the thought of all that he would have to go through. And what did Jesus pray? Those disciples were watching, listening, as Jesus said, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." Watch and pray. Earlier on in this story in Gethsemane, Peter had been pretty brash. Remember what he said? "Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you." Peter, the one that would, by that fire pot warming his hands, deny Jesus. We know how many times. 3. At that moment in time, he should have been doing his watching. And certainly praying for strength from God to help him with the temptations that were coming, rather than sleeping. And when our Savior tells you and me to watch and pray, it's reminding us to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, that author and protector of our faith. You and I, as we watch, as we see our Savior suffering for our sins, not too hard to be mindful of the black, ugly, sooty ones that we've committed. You know, the places that our legs took us that shouldn't have. The places where our eyes looked and lingered and shouldn't have been looking. The words that came out of our mouths, angry and hurtful, that we wish we could reel back in, but we said them anyway. The times when we think to ourselves, "We're pretty good. I was thinking some evil, some hurtful stuff, and I didn't do it." I want to pat ourselves on the back by that sinful thinking stuff. Sin too. Black, ugly, sooty, like ash. Lent is a time to take that look into the deepest recesses and corners of our heart. To go to dark Gethsemane and see all that our Savior endured so that though our sins be as scarlet, his innocent blood, the blood of the innocent Lamb of God, could pay for them. And as we this night watch and pray and look at our Savior and model and mimic his praying, we kind of practice what he did that night. We rehearse it, we repeat it. Every time we say the Lord's Prayer, when we say, "Your will be done," we're asking the Lord to help us accept what He wants for us. And we know how challenging that is at times, to accept the will of our Father in heaven. Oh, we know well that our Heavenly Father always has our best interests at heart. We know well Romans 8:28 that He says all things will work together for the good of those who love Him. We are confident that our God is with us always. And yet, He allows and sends circumstances and situations and things that just test and challenge our Christian walk and faith in the Lord Jesus. And when all those troubling, difficult, challenging, hard times come, then we're glad we've watched Jesus in that garden. And try our very best with the help of God's Spirit working that faith in us to pray like He did. Father, if it's possible, let this cup of suffering. Now, anything that we might suffer, that we might endure, pales in comparison to what Jesus went through. But what a model prayer. We know so many great verses about prayer. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened unto you. We're glad, delighted to have the honor, the privilege to bring all our cares, all our troubles, all our needs, all our sins to our Savior. To know that He hears and heeds those petitions. He helps. He heals. He's there for us. He went to the cross for us. So this evening, as we ponder anew, this time in Gethsemane, as we ponder His three words to watch and pray. Watch. This Lenten season, this Holy Week, this Good Friday, this Palm Sunday, Easter, keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. And be like Jesus in prayer, casting all your cares, all your needs, all your concerns before the Father in heaven, and knowing that He hears, knowing that He answers, knowing that He's always, always, always there for us. We could do no better than to wrap up these few words about watch and pray with the great hymn we sang right before I began. Remember what it said? Go to dark Gethsemane. All who feel the tempter's power, your Redeemer's conflict see. Watch with Him one bitter hour. Turn not from His griefs away. Learn of Jesus Christ to watch and pray. Amen. And now may the peace of our God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts, keep your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We'll now have our ushers gather our offerings for the Lord. I invite us all to again stand in worship as we sing the part that is entitled, "Hear My Prayer, O Lord." Hear my prayer, O Lord.
Listen to my cry.
Keep me as
as the apple of your eye. Righteousness I shall see you.
When I awake, your presence will give me joy.
We pray. Be present, O merciful God, and protect us through the silent hours of this night, so that we who are wearied by the changes and chances of this fleeting world may rest in your eternal changelessness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
O Lord, support us all day long, till the shadows lengthen and the evening comes and the busy world is hushed, and the fever of life is over and our work is done. Then in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging and a holy rest and peace at the last. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
O God, our Father, by your mercy and might, the world turns safely into darkness and returns again to light. We place into your hands our unfinished tasks, our unsolved problems, and our unfulfilled hopes, knowing that only what you bless will prosper. To your great love and protection, we commit each other and all those we love, knowing that you alone are our sure defender. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Keep watch, dear Lord, with those who watch or work or weep this night, and give your angels charge over those who sleep. Tend the sick, give rest to the weary, pity the afflicted, soothe the suffering, bless the dying, and all for your love's sake, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Look down, O Lord, from your heavenly throne, and illuminate this night with your celestial brightness, that by night, as by day, your people may glorify your holy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And we join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Guide us waking, O Lord.
And guide us sleeping.
That awake we may watch with Christ. May rest in peace, Lord, in peace. You let your servants now depart according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared for free people, a light to lighten the Gentiles, and the glory of your people, Israel. In peace. In peace. A word of blessing. The Almighty and most merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless us and keep us.
Amen.
Let's sing our closing hymn, 590, God Who Made the Earth and Heaven. Thank you.
You the night for work have given, for rest the night. May your angel host defend us, slumber sweet, your mercy send us, holy dreams and hopes attend us all through the night. And when morn again shall call us to run life's way, may we still, whate'er befall us, your will obey. From the power of evil hide us, in the narrow pathway guide us, never be your smile denied us all through the day. Guard us waking, guard us sleeping, and when we die, may we in your mighty keeping all peaceful lie. When the last dread call shall wake us, then, O Lord, do not forsake us, but to reign in glory take us with you on high. Holy Father, throned in heaven, all holy Son, Holy Spirit, freely given, blessed three in one. Grant us grace, we now implore you, till we lay our crowns before you, and in worthier strains adore you when ages run.
Please be seated. Good evening. Again, what a joy, what a privilege, what an honor it always is to be over here in Lake Zurich with God's people. Thank you for allowing me to join you in worship. A fantastic supper of all that chicken and wonderful goodies, so thank you for that too. Also, I always like to thank congregations for sharing your pastor with my church. I know his time at Crystal Lake is come and done, but thank you for that. May our God continue to bless you and keep you here. I have to say, I've got these readers up here, and I was saying to somebody before church that one of the nice things this year, last year it was hard. I had cataract surgery done last year, and when I was here, I had one eye done and one eye not done. One eye I could see and one eye I couldn't see. One eye had glass in, and my glasses had glass, and one eye didn't. I could read with one eye, I couldn't read with the other eye. My brain was gone, so it was nice this evening to be able to see you guys clearly and to worship with you. May our God bless you, certainly, as Palm Sunday comes up this Sunday, and all the great worship of Holy Week with Maundy Thursday and Good Friday, and, of course, the grand and glorious celebration of Easter. God's continued blessings. Thank you.